Hello, sim racers, and welcome to our first technical dive into the brand new Assetto Corsa Competizione version 1.8. We have just released the new update. It's out there. If you haven't already, restart your Steam client so that the download can start. It is a big download. It's about 7.5 gigabytes. So yeah, it will need some time. And boy, do we have many, many things to show you. It's going to be the first part or first live stream of talking about physics, simulation, all that stuff. I don't have much time today, but I didn't want to let you without at least the basic things to deal with, to talk about, see and read and listen to your feedback and maybe answer some questions if there are any questions about it. We are going to do more and more and more in the following days, so probably tomorrow, after tomorrow as well, and so on. For my Italian friends, we will also going to do a dedicated Italian marathon about the new physics, possibly in the weekend. So keep on following in the social media and, of course, on our Discord server, and you will find out when I'm going to do the next live streams. Also, keep in mind that if by any means you are going to lose a live stream or whatever, no big deal. I will be cutting into too long didn't watch smaller videos all the basic subjects that we are going to talk about today and in the following days. All right. Let's go. So, first of all, how are you guys doing? I've been reading some enthusiastic comments about the new update, and I'm very, very happy about it. I really have to, first of all, thank a lot, all my colleagues in Kuru Simulazioni, all the developers have been working like crazy in the past, it's practically from spring and on, to make this new version of Unreal Engine work with our code and to improve our dedicated physics engine, which I remind you is a completely different physics engine from the one that Unreal uses in the terms of the core, in the graphics, in the content, in the 3D, in the circuits, in the cars, everywhere. There are improvements pretty much everywhere. It has been a massive effort. It has been a massive effort, not only because obviously as business we want to keep on going and doing well, but also, and I'm not kidding about that, it's not marketing talk, you may believe me or not, but pretty much all of us, we are sim racers, we are dedicated, you know, car enthusiasts. We love what we do. I think we're doing one of the most beautiful, you know, jobs in the planet. It's a hard job. It has lots of stress, but it is wonderful. And the sim racing community has really helped us so much. It has given great support during the damn pandemic. You know, the whole motorsport, real motorsport, was in big trouble. Really big trouble. I think you saw that. That's why we did the keynote and we talk about it. If you haven't, it's just 10 minutes. I advise you to go and see it. But during the pandemic, the whole real motorsport went into big, big trouble. No races, nothing at all. How do you keep sponsors happy? How do you keep investment, you know, viable? How do you get the returns of humans? And so what did they do? They turned around and they found out not only our software, but also amazing communities, organizations, championships, leagues, influencers, YouTubers, everything ready, drivers, everything was there, ready to go. You guys, as always, are organizing everything perfectly. You know how to behave, you know how to do things, from the winners of the eSport competitions to the organizers to the simple users, which are not simple. All you guys are amazingly passionate fans of real motorsport, and that's why we're doing sim racing. That's what we love. And so they found in you a perfect machine, already working, everything is ready, and you practically, up to a point, saved the real motorsport and the sponsors and everything with all the spectacle that you created for keeping, you know, the show to go on, as they say. And because of all of that, we just wanted to thank you somehow. So this update, I believe, shows at least up to a point our appreciation. We did all the extra steps we could do. We never thought about, you know what, yes, let's wrap it up, call it Assetto Corsa 2, change a little bit the graphics or whatever, the backgrounds, and take it out. No, who cares? I mean, we have new things. We can use new technologies. We can use new physics. Take it all, put it in, make it work somehow, take it out, and make people happy. And sorry for the long start of the stream, but I really wanted to tell you this. And let's move on, right? So, Assetto Corsa Competizione version 1.8, big announcement. Let's start. Actually, let me check a little bit the chat. Let's see what you guys are telling about. Nice. All right. Cool. Very good, guys. Yes, Daniele, we are going to do... Daniele, faremo un stream dedicato solo in italiano, possibilmente nel weekend. Lungo stream, tutto in italiano. Che poi ovviamente taglieremo. Okay, so... very, very good. I see you. Many, many happy people. many happy people. All right, Luca Sodano. Guys, a big applause and thank you to Luca Sodano. He's the guy behind all the sounds, the amazing sound, the best sounds in the industry that you can hear inside the Assetto Corsa Competizione. This guy fucks. Yeah, I said it. It is what it is. He's incredible. All right. Okay, so let's go in game, and of course let's start with the big show into Assetto Corsa Competizione version 1.8, and of course it couldn't be anything else than the amazing BMW M4 GT3. What a car! Well, what a car indeed it is. I mean, it barely fits inside the showroom. That thing is big. That thing is really big. It is shorter. It's not as high as the BMW M6. It is as wide, of course, because obviously all the cars go up to the limit of 2 meters and something. But it is even longer. It is even longer, and it is incredible. And I couldn't believe it when we started putting, you know, the data inside the physics engine. So after I put the initial data, I really, you know, wanted to try out the physics and see how the car drives. And I was really skeptical because an even longer car and going away from the V8 to the straight six, which I always loved the straight six, but, you know, straight six V8. 3 liters instead of 4.4 liters, so I was like, meh. Although the data were, you know, watching and reading the matrix, the data were seeming amazing, were looking amazing, but, you know, you really want to drive it. And so I went out and start driving, and I was like, no, wait a minute. It's one of those cases where the sum of the data, you know, makes something that is bigger and better than the single data shows you. So everything together works really well. This car is agile. It has a great front end. It has a great rear end stability. The driving feel is so good for the driver. And I believe it's going to be a great protagonist in the series, the real series as well. Because we all know the BOP will come in and hit the car, and it will make it slower than what it actually is. We'll know how it works. This is also one reason why the series is so successful, because all the cars are very, very close in performance. But I think this car is going to get a lot of clients, because I think in BMW they've been smart. instead of going for full performance, and they did go for full performance, actually, the car is really quick. But as you know, the full performance, the performance can be handicapped by the balance of performance by the BOP. So what they did was make a very friendly package. So the car is really friendly to the driver. It doesn't... It helps you stay on top of your performance and or your limits for more time. So you can push and push and push without, you know, having to get tired a lot. So you can really stay right at the limit of the car and take advantage of all the performance that the car can give you without, you know, suffering in the meantime. So I think they've been smart. We will see how the car will perform. Obviously, initially, they will need to find out how to set up the car and everything. And I'm pretty sure, you know, the BOP will hammer it strongly initially. But yeah, we have it on the sim and it's really amazing. So let's go and have a look right inside the game. Where can we go? Let's go somewhere. Give me a track, guys. Do you know a track? Would you like a track to go? Guys, as usual, consoles get everything later. We cannot release the things together with the console. And unfortunately, I'm not the guy to tell you about consoles. So let me know. I cannot tell you things about the console because I don't know them in detail. So please follow the official channels of Kunos and Assetto Corsa, and you will get all the information when time is due from there. German Nürburgring, all right, or Imola. Imola is also good, yeah. Imola. Everybody says Imola. Okay. Let's go Imola. I like Imola. And it is a very, very technical track, so let's go over there and have some fun. Let's go a little bit late in the evening, always nice. And yeah, clear, fine. Okay, let's go there. All right, loading. How many steering angle? I don't know. You shouldn't do that, mate. For PC, you shouldn't really do that. All you have to do is set your steering wheel at 900 degrees. And the game will take care of everything else. You shouldn't change the steering lock. I understand that console, old generation console guys still have to do that. I think so. I don't know if they got out with the highly requested patch for that. But for PC, you should just set it to 900. How much slower are we? From half a second to 2 seconds, depending car, track combination and weather combination. I agree that steering angle doesn't have bump stop on Logitech or whatever other wheels, Natalie, but still, to arrive to the bump stop, you know, to the end of the lock, you are in situations where you have practically lost the wheel, so the car. So for 99% of the driving, you don't need it. I believe, yes, the more dynamic car will bring the fields closer. I hope so. You can never tell. Everything is slower, yes. You will be slower, so don't worry about that. In my Discord server, I already pinned a post about what to take care, you know, and relax. So don't try to push to do the same lap times. Take it slower. I don't know, Kianik. Yeah, we saw there were drift cars, but we can't. Higher brake bias. I don't think so. That's an idea, Carbon. Totally, Polman. GT4. The new update impacts all cars, all tires. It's not something specific. The average race, I think the Lambo is in the best state ever. I think yesterday we had the proof of that. Isn't the longer wheelbase of the M4 an issue for hairpins? Actually, this is one of the points that you might feel that the car is a little bit too long, but normally you don't feel it. In Italiano, probably nel weekend. Still the same ideal pressure, but a little bit wider range, so maybe you want to try a little bit more. Yes, even the 2018 tires. Or we don't do specific force feedback for steering wheels. It just, you know, works for all. Yeah, you need to use wider brake ducts. Okay, guys, let's see a little bit the car. Okay, let's check a little bit the car. Go here, check the aggressive setup, and have a look at the car. Well, first of all, let's have a look at the car right away. Oops, sorry. Let's have a look at the car.
Green light. Go, go, go.
I mean, as usual, wonderful, wonderful detailing and 3Ds by our artist, as usual. Amazing job everywhere. Tons and tons of detail. Look at this wonderful exhaust here on the side, which is pretty strange that they close this, because obviously they are limiting a little bit the outcome of the hot air from the brakes. But it is like this from this way, and it is asymmetrical from the other way. So it is like that from the other way here. It's a little bit strange. Sorry about this. Ah, I've lost the mouse. Give me a second, guys. All right. Return to the garage again. Yeah. Okay. So let me also stop this mouse sharing for a moment, because otherwise I'm gonna have issues. Okay, so did you know? Let's go back to the did you know that some cars have fuel screens on the body panels on close to the to where you are refueling the car. So, for example, for the BMW, we have the actual number of liters. You can also have something similar, I think, to the Ferrari and a couple of other cars. And of course, this thing here is not just simulated or it's a texture, but it's actually working. So if we go back to the fuel here, you can see it already in the background. I can change this, and of course you can see it working already. Yeah, how cool is that, right? And of course it works in real time. If you just start the car and step on it. By the way, let me also show you. Look at how different the throttle response is now. You can keep a little bit of throttle and it doesn't go instantly up like before. But if you nail it, also listen to the soft limiter for some cars. In a moment, we will see that it will go down to 61. It might need some time. Yeah, it takes a little bit of time. Well, in the meantime, we can move.
I've got some light damage on the front of the car.
I don't know where I'm going. Should be going to 61 in a minute. Yep, 61. You see, so it's dynamic. And now you know. All right, so let's do a lap with the car and talk a little bit generically what to expect, not only from the car, but also from the physics and so on. All right, so here we go. Cold tires, relatively, they still heat up to 70 degrees from the tire blankets, but also low pressures. Now, when the pressures, whoa, when the pressures are like that, the tires are nasty, they are nervous, they are very sudden when they lose traction and grip. So you need to be a little bit careful, right? You see, the car is fast to lose control. Also, the understeer is sudden here. You need to work a little bit. And they feel a little bit now like wooden, you know, it's not gradual what they're doing. So you need to be a little bit careful. This was also happening in Assetto Corsa Competizione in the previous version, but now the feeling is a little bit different. I can't read the chat and work together. All right, so we now need to heat up the tires a little bit first. You can also see how the car jumps a little bit around on the caps, and see here how it just snapped a little bit, but the tires now should start coming into temperature. And now we will notice a couple of things. Look how it went over the sausages without big effort. And now there is more grip. The tire is softer because it's hotter. When the tire is hot, the chemical chemicals inside the tire start to make bonds, and so they permit to the tire to absorb and stick to the ground better. And so you don't only get better grip, you get different characteristics, you get different behavior from the tire. And this is now simulated even better, and I believe is one of these subtle things that you need some experience to understand, but modern simulators now are really into this kind of approach, and it's so good. Look at how it goes over the curbs now. You see? You see how the car absorbed the curbs. You also saw how you can notice how the car is very agile on turning in, and it still maintains the rear end stability. Very good turn in, rear end stability, so you're not really risking life when you're turning in like that. It's really good. So tires are almost good now. A little bit on the cold side, but still very good. So let's do a lap and have some fun over the curbs. Ah, did you saw that? See how the car absorbs the curbs now. Another great thing of this engine is the amount of torque you have. You can even leave third gear here. Look how the kilometers are raising. You don't even need to downshift. Obviously, you are a bit faster, but sincerely, many times you can just leave the third gear or the fourth gear in, and the car just accelerates. This is one also of the reasons why they've made the gear ratios a little bit too long. But in the end, you know, it practically has a flat torque curve from, like, I don't know, 2,000, 3,000 RPM up to the limiter. It's just flat. It just goes like this. See how the car absorbs the curbs. It It's also now more predictable when you have some, you know, loss of grip or traction. So you just saw the oversteer there, just a flick of the wrist, of the broken wrist, and you can control the car without big issues. It's still a GT3 car. You need to be a little bit faster than a street car in controlling it. And you need to have smaller steering angles. But it's much more controllable than before. So actually, let's go down to traction control 1. Now that the tires are hot. See how much traction there is. Ah, wonderful. You saw that? Obviously, if I'm doing this, I'm losing time. But you still have control, and the car doesn't snap totally out of you, out of control. See how it jumps? It bounces, but absorbs. So, yes, there is more bouncing probably, but it absorbs the heat and it doesn't lose the grip from the bouncing. Look at this, wonderful. Such a good car, really majestic. Look at that, fantastic. Great. Let's have a look at the replay and explain a couple of things, shall we? Yeah, okay. Let's go into the replay, have a look on those laps. Actually, let's see if we can explain what is happening at the initial lap. All right, here we are. So, already here, you can see when I went over the sausages here, you see how the car hole jumped, right? Now, obviously, I got the curb not as well as I should, but still, when the tire is cold, even though it has less pressure and should absorb better, it is more bouncy. It doesn't have enough dampening to absorb the heat well. And you can also see here, when I'm exiting in low gear, you see how it instantly rotated and I had to be very fast to catch it. On the next laps with more temperature, you'll see how the tires are stickier and they can also absorb better all the various situations that I can throw into them. So, a little bit of extra talk about the car. Okay, we've lost it here. But again, this is part of, you know, the cold tires right now. You can see that the car is long. Why the car is so long? Why BMW decided to go for such a long car? Long car means also very long under tray. And long under tray means you can work better and have a laminar flow when the air arrives to the diffuser. And more air and more undisturbed air arriving to the diffuser, it means much better and more stable downforce production. And it also means that you don't need as high rear wing angles to produce downforce. You don't suffer for as much pitch sensitivity as other cars that might be shorter. And all that makes the car easier to the driver. As you can see, the car is extremely, extremely benevolent and very, very predictable, which is a really good thing. I remind you that GT3 series is a client series. GTE on the WEC, these are, you know, actual manufacturers' works cars racing with professional drivers. And professional drivers can obviously be much more precise to their driving, and they are trained to do so, and they can usually ask a far more aggressive car that has better performance. But in GT3 racing, we have client driving, which means that we also have drivers that they are not professional, they are gentleman drivers. Still very good drivers, but they don't have all the experience, or maybe they don't have the time to, you know, train themselves as much as the professional drivers. Having a car that it is both fast, but also very predictable and benevolent to the driver and doesn't ask for crazy inputs, you know, to be fast, is key for this kind of racing. And that BMW is exactly why it's made in this way. Yes, Emil, it's dropping down because actually the whole car is made in a way that it doesn't provoke crazy oversteers. It's all, as you know, pit sensitivity. So Emil asks, why when in the BMW we put the rear right height very high, so high rake, the front tire variation is dropping instead of getting even more front aero balance. So you might have noticed, and you might notice in the future as well, that the next generation of GT3 cars, they try to get more clean air from the rear wing and having possibly less downforce generated by the diffuser. And they try also to make the front end to not be as pitch sensitive as usual. And that is all happening because that is the big problem, okay, with the gentleman drivers. If you are going into a very high speed turn and you release the accelerator, you even touch the brake a little bit, the whole aero balance moves to the front and makes the car unstable. Gentleman drivers are not so used to deal with that. It is dangerous for them. And so, in the new generation of GT3 cars, they try to make the cars less speed sensitive. So what is happening with this car, for example, is that if you create lots of rake, so very high rear end, very low front end, at some point, instead of getting more and more downforce to the front, the rear wing will start getting lots of fresh air, lots of clean air, and it will generate more downforce, because obviously if you have high rake, it means that the rear wing also gets more rake as well, right? Look at how nice this drift goes. And this means that you generate more rear downforce as well, and the car becomes again more stable. Right. So I'm pretty sure you're gonna see this kind of design, aero design, in more GT3 cars in the future, in the near future. So, for example, the new Audi Evo 2, the new Audi R8 Evo 2. If you have seen already some of the technical articles about it, they say that it has a bigger rear wing and kind of smaller rear diffuser, which again shows that they are trying, you know, to generate a more stable car that is not as nervous from aerodynamic pitch sensitivity. All right, so okay, so this is more or less about the car, right? We talk a little bit about the tires and how let's start again. Yeah, maybe a different camera. And how the tires change behavior when they are hot, cold, or perfect. Okay, we also talked about how the tires absorb now the bumps and the curbs when they are hot and in the correct temperature, right? Cool. You might have also noticed how the car bounces and how it absorbs well the curbs and the bumps. It's not just the tires, of course. We have also something new inside the physics engine, so we are calculating something extra now. Now, as you know, in GT3 racing and practically all modern race cars which have advanced aerodynamics, okay? So, in all modern cars with advanced aerodynamics, because of the aero pit sensitivity, the cars use bump stops, right? And they use bump stops in order to limit the pits of the cars. So what you're normally using, you have your springs, and normally the suspension moves around in the springs, and then at some point it touches the bump stop, and the bump stop have a non-linear spring rate. They are progressive, which means the more you compress them, and the way more their spring rate raises. So they become more and more stiff as you compress them. Which is great for, you know, having the front end not touching the ground and provoking great aerodynamic instability. But as usual, things are not, you know, you always have to do a compromise. Why is that? Because obviously having such a stiff spring rate at the front, it means that the car will bounce into curbs and bumps. It will even jump. You will have more mechanical understeer. You will put more strain into the tires, and so on and so on. So it's always a compromise, but pretty much you cannot do without them for most of the cases. Now, what was the issue? While Assetto Corsa Competizione was simulating the non-linear bump stop in a great way, and they are actually needed because of the very good aerodynamic simulation, the problem is that in Assetto Corsa Competizione, the bump stop was nothing more than an extra progressive spring. So you had your suspension spring, and on top of that, you have the bump stop, which was another spring. Right? Now, why is this bad, practically? Because it means that when you are riding on the bump stop and you are compressing the bump stop, okay, you are getting a very, very stiff spring, and you have lots of energy inside that double spring, practically. Which means that at the moment that you release this energy, right, so you went over the curb here, for example, you see, over the curb, finished. This double spring will release the energy and will make the car, the body, jump. Okay, and that was something that you have all experienced into Assetto Corsa Competizione. And to control this, you either needed to take compromised racing lines, so you wouldn't touch the curbs or whatever. While in reality, we've seen sometimes, you know, the drivers going even over strange curbs like Monza. We can show this in a minute. Or you needed to compromise with the dampers. So you needed stiffer dampers or strange dampers or very stiff dampers in order to control the energy released by this double spring, okay? Okay, fine. At some point, you know, you could do it, no big deal. So what is changing with version 1.8? We are now simulating the self-dampening of the bump stop. What that means? Well, the spring is a spring. If you take a spring and you throw it down to the ground, it will bounce upright up to you. It will make a big jump, right? But the bump stop is rubber. And rubber, usually, if you throw it down to the ground, it will make a jump, but it will be much less jump. It will not jump off the ground instantly because, as you know, the rubber will compress a little bit, but then while decompressing, it will make a self-dampening of the energy. and will provoke heat, of course, but that doesn't, it's not important for us. So it acts differently. It's not a metallic spring, it is a completely different thing. So in Assetto Corsa Competizione version 1.8 now, we simulate this damp effect of the bump stop, which means that the bump stop will of course absorb the energy from bump and heat and saucers and big curb, whatever, but then it will not release it instantly. It will release it slowly. This means not only that the car will perform better and behave better over curbs like this situation over here. So look, for example, how the car now absorbs much better the high curbs right here. All right, have a look at this. Look at that. Small bump going down and instantly sets. It doesn't bounce again, right? So not only this will happen, but there is also an extra advantage. You can now make less compromise with your dampers for the actual handling of the car, for the actual suspension. So the dampers now are even more sensitive and change a little bit better the behavior of the car, because they don't have to account for the bump stop as much as before. So this is interesting, and I believe that slowly people will start working with the dampers better. Possibly I can explain them even better as well, and start having some better, you know, rules about them, and most importantly, gain some extra performance, or at least gain some better handling from the car, because we can work better with the dampers. Now, all of that, okay, wouldn't have been as good as it is now with the refresh rate that we had in the physics engine. As you know, in the simulators, a physics engine refreshes a number of times in a second. This is the refresh rate. So that means that in a second, our physics engine will collect all the data, make the calculations, and then release all the data to make the car change behavior, and then recollect from there, and so on and so on. Okay. And this happens until now 333 times per second for the whole physics engine. So every second, our physics engine will calculate 333 times. Okay? Now, this is a very good number, by all means, but it's also not reality. Reality is almost endless, you know, it's infinite, the amount. And the higher the speed, the more this is a limiting factor. Because, for example, let me give you an example that I've written somewhere, because I don't remember all that stuff by memory, of course. So let me just find out exactly the example that I have made for you to make it understood better. All right, so here it is. So what it means, to give you an example, at 250 kilometers per hour, okay, the car moves, we have to make this meters per second, because we said that we are refreshing 333 times per second. So instead of talking kilometers per hour, let's talk meters per second, okay? So 250 kilometers per hour is 69 meters per second, okay? That means that every second, okay, your car moves by 69 meters. And those 69 meters, our physics engine refreshes 333 times, okay, during those 69 meters, okay? What that means? It means that if you have, it means that your ground collisions are updated every 21 centimeters. So we refresh one time, the car moves by 21 centimeters, and we refresh another time again. Okay, that is what it means. which means 21 centimeters could be the difference by feeling the step on a curb or not. Okay? That is why on some very older simulators that had even lower refresh rates, okay, you could go, the faster you could go over the curbs, and the smoother the curbs would feel. Because practically, the refresh rate was not fast enough to get all the steps of the curb, right? So again, old physics engine, we would refresh at 250 kilometers every 21 centimeters. In version 1.8, because of big optimization into our physics engine, we are now capable of refreshing every 400 times per second. Now, one might say, well, you know, okay, 333 to 400, it's not a big deal. In reality, it is 20% improvement, and it means that instead of refreshing every 21 centimeters, we now refresh every, if I'm not wrong, 17 centimeters. So it is quite an important improvement over there. And it doesn't stop just in the horizontal movement of the car. There are even higher speeds where the suspension and the tires move up and down. So now this is key. When the suspension and the dampers move up and down, they create oscillation, and that oscillation has a frequency. And at very high frequencies, like when the tire goes over the curb steps, for example, you need to have the physics engine calculating the springs and the dampening of the springs. And this is very high refresh, right? Which means that now we have a 20% improvement over there. We can calculate those oscillations even better. So let's see, except that replay, let's also try and find out, and let me show you if I can find an example of how this thing improves the behavior of the car in even more extreme conditions. So let's go at Monza, for example. Okay, right, here. Let's go at Monza. Start practice, and I want to do a couple of laps going into some specific, you know, curbs and see what happens. This also helps a little bit with collisions, yes, as well. Now 200, I think we stayed in 200 hertz for Motec. All right, so typical aggressive setup. We're not doing strange things here. And let's go.
Green light, go, go, go.
Hey, straight six. Straight six, baby, yeah. Let's go. Oops, sorry, I went a little bit too far. My bad. But anyway, we still have to heat up the tires and everything. Really long fifth gear. I believe it it helps to stay on fifth gear here. Did you just saw that? Did you saw what I did? I went over the sausage and nothing really strange happened. So the car just absorbed the whole sausage over there. Obviously, you cannot be crazy, but... Ah, how was that? And we still have cold tires. So obviously, if you hit the sausage with the whole under tray or the splitter, the car will jump, right? Because it's, you know, completely stiff body panel against the ground. You cannot expect something different. But if you do it as the professional do, and I advise you to check a couple of live videos on YouTube from real races, you can see how the real driver managed to hit those high curbs with just the wheel, just the tire. So they go over with the tire and they climb over there with the tire, and eventually the whole car is on top of the high curb, but the cars do not jump. This is something that it was very hard to do, or almost impossible to do, with the old version. Now it's much possible. You see that? Over the curb. A little bit of bounce. Not big deal of a jump, but completely under control with the car handling. Look at this. How was that? That was pretty good, right? Do you remember the dreadful curb of death of Lesmo 2? Yeah, no big deal, right? I know the feeling. Now, again, that doesn't mean that, oh yeah, it's silly easy, no problems, all the car can do it, you know. But it is definitely doable. It needs technique, it needs precision, but you can do it now without losing time. Actually, the opposite. You could even gain some time if you do it properly. Again, the tires are a little bit hotter now, so let's try it. Aha! Look at this control over here with the traction control greatly limiting the exit. Okay, let's try it again. One more time. You see? Not bad at all, right? This is the aggressive setup. You see now, if you catch the curb with the under tray, obviously the whole car jumped. But even in that worst case scenario, you saw that after the jump, the car just landed and stopped bouncing. Perfect. Really, you know, it starts to feel like a race car. Stable, you know, stiff but planted. It's really good. By no means easier, because you can easily do an error and spin it and overdo it. But really feels well, and you can see that you can doing things that you can also do in from the real drivers in the real series. Let's see this now from the replay. So let's stop here. Okay, so let's have a look at the replay. I think it's a very nice thing. Go over here. Look at how it goes up, goes down, no big deal. We will talk about that in a minute. Let's go also in Variante 2. Look at Variante 2 again. Up the curb, boom! Very nice absorption. And again, let's go from the other side. Oops, sorry. And let's see how it absorbs. No problems at all. You can see that the car stays a little bit on the two wheels and then instantly landed, absorbed the heat, and there you go. Look at this. Look at how nicely it absorbs the whole. And let's go one more time over here. this side. And up goes. Oops, I've missed it here, possibly. Yeah, look at that. Completely took the whole curb. And look how the tires are flexing. Boom. Boom. Look at the big flex of the tire when it landed. But the rest of the suspension absorbed the heat for us. Let's go also into Variante 2. I think we took it from the other side. Again, let's have a look. Yeah, look at this. Boom. Fantastic. This is really, really cool. And it also looks very nicely from the outside, so... Oops. Look at this. Look how smooth it looks. Boom. And natural. You can feel the car. And now one of the great things is that doesn't only bounce up and down, but you can also see the car flexing also left and right. It's really, really cool. How do the GT4 cars? Well, let's have a look at what is happening. So we talk about a little bit of the heat of the tires. We talk about a little bit of the bump stops. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the camber. All right, so let's try something different. We still have a little bit of time. We are just touching and scrubbing the surface right now, guys. Lots of dice, Enzi. Lots of dice thrown. Yes, Romano. This is normal. We will talk about this in a moment or tomorrow, but it is normal, and the closer they are, the better it is for your tire wear and grip. All right, so let's have a look. Well, first of all, you know, guys, now we have all the series here, and of course the open series where you can select practically any car you want. Okay, so let's go and get the Cayman GT4, a typical, you know, car for GT4. Everybody loves this. And let's go to Barcelona, because I want to show you something. Ats, we just explained everything about the 400 Hz. We just finished the whole discussion about it. Wi-Fi tip. No, if your setups are not extreme and they are not taking into advantage of some exploits or whatever, the setups that you have and of course the presets should work just fine. Obviously, fine-tuning and tweaking will always be needed. As usual, we do not, we cannot possibly give the perfect setup for everybody. But you know, normal setups should work without problems. No, FSR dovrebbe funzionare con tutte le schede video e hardware. All right, so aggressive setup. Yes, Phantom, there will be a quiz tomorrow. Yes, tomorrow with your parents, guys, and we will have a quiz. Yes, Aspe, all the changes affect how the tires react to wet circuit. Hey, Donzo, thank you so much for the support, mate. Thank you. Really appreciate it. Lots of beer for all the development team. Thank you. Okay, so let's go. Let's go. As usual, the GT4 cars start with cold tires, no blankets. No, Mr. KS Pell, all cars are slower from half a second to 2 seconds, depending on car track combination and weather conditions. So don't worry about it, guys. Again, don't worry about lap times. Enjoy the driving for now. You will need a little bit of time to get used to it. And the lap times will be slower for everybody, so don't worry. Look at the understeer that I'm having now because of the cold tires. Well, oh, SD Apps Racing. No, it's not a disaster, mate. You probably have some issues with configuration. Everybody's showing, you know, much better frame rate everywhere. So honestly, those comments that, oh, it's a disaster. Guys, take some time. Play a little bit with your configurations. I mean, come on, seriously. Yeah, I think it's probably too early here. Oops. But you saw how it jumped on that curb, right? Okay, let's heat up the tires a little bit more. You can also see on the tires HUD how the surface of the tires becomes much faster yellowish or even oranges, and then cools down again. This is the surface temps of the tires, that they are much more dynamic now. They are going up and down in temperature much faster. Fabio! Oh, thank you so much, mate. Thank you so much, Fabio. Look at how the GT4 cars are so much nicer to drive around in slight drifts, because obviously, yeah, look at this. Because obviously they only have mechanical grip, they don't have aerodynamics and extremely stiff setups to make things more, you know, tricky. Look at that. Well, I'm with TC off right now, by the way. Wonderful. Okay, let's go back to TC1. Ooh, yeah. All right, let's see if we can try this now. Did you saw those two wheeling over there? Ooh, yeah. Pressures are still not perfect, so let me still try to get the pressures properly up. Oh, I went a little bit too long. My bad. I was reading the chat. Look how this car absorbed those sausages over there. We'll talk about this in a moment. For the damper setting on the force feedback. We will also try to make the GT Force even closer than before, if possible. We're also expecting to see what is going to happen with the, you know, the BOP of 2021 or whatever on the GT Force. I've missed the curb. I'm such an idiot. One lap for nothing. Okay, maybe we can check the previous lap. So, what I wanted to show you. See if we can. Boom. Can you see how the car goes into two wheels and stays there for a moment? Let's have a look again. Look at this. Jump and stays there and then absorbs. Let's see it also on the next curbs here. Boom. Look at the how it absorbs the curb. And boom again. And then great control of the oversteer. So, what is happening here? We have a new camber simulation, right? We've improved on the previous camber simulation we had, and we went an extra step forward and all over. So, the one of the things that we improved is how the camber generates grip. We already had a very good generation of grip for negative camber, but as the camber was going to more and more and more positive values, it would lose more and more and more grip. The rate of loss of grip for positive camber was way too much. It wasn't a big deal because the situations where you go on to into two-wheeling like that are minimal when racing, but still it wasn't correct, and we had to do something about it. So now we have a much better gradient of how the tires are losing grip as they are going into positive camber, and that improves not only the as you can see here, right? It doesn't improve just the spectacle of the car going into two wheels and staying there for a moment, and with, you know, cars with even higher COG, you could even get really close to, you know, 40 degrees or something. But, I mean, look at how natural it is. It's amazing. Wow, look at this. I love it. So, it doesn't improve just that, but also improves other extreme situations. So, for example, when the tire goes over a curb that is pretty high, this changes a lot the camber of the tire to the surface, because obviously the camber is negative to a flat surface, but then if the surface is not flat anymore and horizontal, the whole camber changes. It changes also how the internal wheel generates grip, because the internal wheel, obviously, if you have something like, you know, -3 negative camber, you have it for the external wheel, the internal wheel automatically, it's -3, but because you are turning into this side, it becomes positive camber for that side, right? And it becomes positive value like positive 3 or positive 4 degrees. And now, it generates more traction, even if it's in positive camber values. That means that, you know, over the curbs they behave better, it gives you more traction, it makes the car jump and stay on two wheels even more. And while we were there, we said, okay, let's push it even farther, and now we have a much better simulation from the values in terms of what kind of side forces and realignment forces the tires generate from extreme camber values. Okay. Now, what I mean by this? Let's change car once more. Go to an interesting track that will permit us to showcase this. And have a go. So, when you have extremely fat, very wide, slick tires, right? And you give on those slick tires lots of negative, lots of camber, positive or negative. It's obvious that those guys are going to generate a lot of lateral force, you know, even if you're going straight, okay? And now imagine this happening at minus 3.5 or minus 4 degrees of camber, okay? But imagine going into a curve where for a moment you have the curve that it is like this and you get even more negative camber, or the curve is a step and so half the tire is over there and half the tire is under the curve and half the tire is over the curve. Or imagine, I don't know, let's get the Porsche, the Ferrari, for example. Imagine having a longitudinal bump into the road, for example, okay? So what is going to happen is when you're going over this kind of curbs, the tire will want to follow, if they are longitudinal, they will want to follow the bump or the curb or the line, whatever, and they will want to follow it and not going instantly over that. It's easy to think about it if you ever, guys, you know, as kids went around with your bicycles and you would go close to, I don't know, the walkway, right? Now, if you go parallel to the walkway, the wheel of the bicycle will want to go straight while we will go to go left or right, and you will want to fall over because the bicycle will follow the sidewalk, right? If you go not parallel but in a great angle, then you can go over it, okay? So all this stuff happens when you have to deal with parallel and longitudinal bumps and curbs and whatever of the road. Okay, so let's go and get the aggressive setup. Use as much negative camber as we can here and have a go. As you know, Misano has some... It might not be very high, the curbs, but they are stepped and they are a little bit strange, so... Let's have a go.
Green light. Give it all you can.
I will also raise a little bit the force feedback here, risking my health, but I want to show you better what is happening. So possibly even lower this a little bit, like that. Let me see if you guys can see it. All right. Yeah. I think. Let me see if you can see this. Yeah, I think you can see better the steering wheel now. Alright. So let's heat up the tires a little bit. Uah. Yeah, Ferrari, baby. Can already go here. See how the steering wheel moves out of my hands and wants to follow what is happening in the road. Look at this. Look, you can see the whole car moving around like that. It's not just the force feedback. But the whole car wants to change direction. And the tires are not even hot yet, so they don't even generate as much you know, grip as they can. Oh, too much. My bad. Oh, look at this. You can already see how the car tries to follow those high curbs when you are longitudinal with them. You attack the curbs, you know, not parallel, and you don't have big issues. Yes, you will feel movements and everything, but you won't have big issues. You going over the curbs longitudinally, and the problems start. And of course, the higher the curb, the worse it is. Like this here, for example. Whoa, you can see how it moves around. Look at this. Ah, see how it moves. So, usually aliens, they will still do it. They try to brake as wide as they can over there to gain more space. They will still do it, but you can see that it's not as easy anymore because the car moves around much more. Look at this. So this is called tramlining. This is the correct term. Tramlining, so that you follow the lines of tram, you know, or trains, whatever. And of course it affects not only your force feedback, which someone could say, oh yeah, all right, I will, you know, lower the force feedback, I won't feel it. Of course you're gonna lose some feedback. but it also affects the actual handling of the car, especially at the rear end, because you don't really want to go over the curb parallelly and having the rear end moving around, or possibly, you know, you might not feel it that much, but then you go turning in to the turn and you have the rear end stepping out because it was already, you know, moving around and was losing grip already. Look at this. Okay, I guess it's clear. All right, so, okay, how do we fix that? Well, as usual, everything in the setup is a compromise. Everything is a compromise. So, you don't have problem. I mean, you have issues. So, for example, you go into Snetterton on Ulton Park, which are extremely bumpy tracks and have very strange curbs, even higher than Misano. And if you go over there with full camber, you will feel the car being very nervous. It moves around a lot. It doesn't go exactly where you want. Okay, how do we fix that? Well, we can lower the negative camber. Let's go minus 3 and minus 2.8 here. It's still high. Obviously, lowering the negative camber, you're going to lose some lateral grip. Okay, you have to find the compromise. You have to understand what's going on and how you can improve on that, all right? But it is possible to compromise. So let's go a little bit lower here, just to show you the effect, the opposites, right? So you can understand what is going on. I wouldn't recommend to go as low as that. You can feel the difference already by going down to 3 at the rear, for example. But I want to show you the difference. Sky, oh my god, thank you so much, mate. Guys, thank you so much for your support today. It's so cool. Really appreciate it. Alright, so now we have again the same car, same setup, same everything. And we don't have as much negative camber as before. Alright? So let's see what's going to happen. Pretty much nothing. Something happening, obviously. It's not that it goes away instantly, but it's nothing happened really. It's nothing tragic. Look at this. Wonderful. Wonderful. Look at that. No problems. Just went over the curbs. This is exactly what happens with your street cars all the street cars have cambers, even the ones with very wide tires, they have cambers that go up to like minus 0.5 degrees, minus 0.1 degree at most, right? Maybe a little bit more at the rear for the front-wheel drive cars. And obviously you feel nothing of this kind of movements into the steering wheel, right? But even if you take a street car and you start using, you know, high cambers, negative cambers like minus 3.3 I have on my Miata, for example, you start feeling more of this kind of situations. Still not much, because obviously the Miata has only 195 wide front tires, so not a big deal. But if you put minus 3 degrees on a car that has 325 millimeters front tires, or rear for that matter, yes, you're gonna feel strange things. So here you have now less camber, nothing moves on my steering wheel. I can go over the curbs with no problems at all. Again, you might ask, should I use as low camber as possible? Absolutely not. But sometimes on some tracks you need to find the compromise, or at least be aware that on some occasions going over the curb like this, if you have lots of camber, it won't be as easy as now, but the car will move around. Not just the first feedback, but the whole car will move around. Let's have a look of this into the replay. Again, from the outside, I think you're gonna enjoy it. Let's go over the tires like that and see how the car moves around. Look at the tires also, how they flex and bend. Look at now. Look how the whole car will move around. See that movement that it made? That was the tires trying to follow. Sotiri! Ευχαριστώ πολύ. Γεια σου φίλε Σωτήρη, ευχαριστώ. Να είσαι καλά. Look at this. Look at how that. Did you saw that, guys? Let me show you this one more time. Even slower. Now I want you to watch how the tires try to go up and down on the curb. So I'm going here, there, and the tires start to go up, then up, then, and they move to the opposite. So it doesn't go normally over the curb. They want to move opposite. They want to follow the tram line, you know. And I didn't do anything on the steering wheel. It did all by itself, the tire, right? So let's move a little bit farther ahead here. Again here, you can see how the tire wants to, you see, the whole car doesn't want to go inside. It stays there, okay? So this is, for me, it's pretty exciting, it's pretty cool to show. Let's go from the other side here. And the most wonderful thing is now that you can feel it actually on the steering wheel. Look at this, look at how the tires try to... this is cool here, let me try to go closer if possible. Look at how the tire is following the curb. Did you see the flex of the tire? Let's go also the next one here, turning. Look at how the tire moves around. Did you saw that? Okay, let's go really slow here. Try to see if we can show you. So look at the side goal of the tire. You see how it tries to move around again? And when you go over the curb, it will move away. Boom, like that. That's what's going. That's what's going on. So this is actually what is happening. This is all about the camber and what it creates and how it works, and why you feel what you are feeling right now in the first feedback. It will take some time for some of you to get accustomed to this, but it is more realistic. It's more correct this way, and I'm pretty sure that you will like it very, very, very soon. And I also know that some of you already love it. So, yeah. As usual, again, I will say this. Trying to get more realistic doesn't always mean making the game more fun. Okay. Sometimes the game in some condition will result more exciting, because driving is exciting, but also more frustrating. It will ask for you. Did you saw how the car moved over there? That was really cool. Look at that. Look at the rear end. Look at the rear wing. Look at the rear wing. Focus on the rear wing. You see how the rear wing moved? It had nothing to do with my steering inputs. It did all that because it went over the curb, and the rear end didn't want to climb over the curb because of the very high camber. So, sometimes, as I was saying, the game will not be more fun. It will not be more enjoyable. It will not be, even though, you know, it depends on the perspective. So for me, it's more fun and it is more enjoyable because it's more realistic and I love real driving. But for some of you that might not have as much experience from real driving, it might seem that it is more frustrating. So why should I feel that? But that's what simulation is. Simulation is, you know, who cares what's the end result if we validated from feedback, telemetry, and everything that it is correct? If the end result is more correct, this is the way to go. All right? So this is what is going on. Okay. So to close the live stream, because unfortunately I don't have all that time today, I would like to just show you one new thing that we have into the controls. All right? So let me show you the controls of the game regarding the force feedback. So let's go to the options, controls. Now we are here. Let me also check so that you can see the mouse. I believe that now you can see the mouse as well. I hope so. all right, so is this correct? No, that's not correct. This should be more correct. Forgive me about that. Okay. So, in the controls, obviously now we have the frequency updated to 400 Hz. We also, as usual, you can lower this to 133 or 266. So you have different steps. Why you would want to use different steps or lower steps? Well, some wheels might not have electronics that can deal with such high frequencies, and they might flat out all the feedback that is arriving and filter it out. So you might want to use a lower frequency. Try it. It's not a problem. It's not a big deal. You can try it easily. No problems at all. You might even get better feedback than before. Okay. And that's one thing. Now, that's about the frequency. But we have a new thing here called damper, right? Damper. Now, since the initial steps of Assetto Corsa Competizione, we always wanted you to have a little damping in the steering wheel. Now, unfortunately, we've learned that not all drivers deal with the damping inside games in the same way. So we might have enabled the damping in the game, but for whatever reason, it is not working because of whatever the driver is doing, or it is not working because the profile of the driver, by the way, driver profiles are the devil. My advice, do not use driver profiles because often you do an update and they lose the .exe of the game, or they lose the connection or whatever, and they don't work anymore, and you end up coming to the forums and asking why my steering wheel doesn't work anymore, why my video card doesn't work anymore, and it is usually because of the driver profiles. If you insist on using them, then keep in mind that often every time you update something, any game, you also need to go and re-update your driving profile, or at least relink with the exe of the game. This is an error that I've seen many times, and it is one of the common reasons that many people simply don't feel the first feedback as they should, because simply the driver profile does not connect to the game and gives no feedback or stupid feedback completely. So check this. Okay, fine. Now, as we said in Assetto Corsa Competizione, we always intended to experience it with a little bit of damping. Why is that? Because the tires give so much force, and because it's simply not realistic to have the steering wheel completely free, that you can move it around and it doesn't stop and it moves around like crazy, okay? Or you go into the straight line and the steering wheel, if you leave it, starts oscillating like crazy and oscillates even more, and then at the end the car spins, all right? This is not how real steering wheels work, okay? All steering wheels have a small amount of damping, either from the mechanic or from the tires or whatever. So, Assetto Corsa Competizione, to be experienced in a proper way, asks for some damping in the steering wheel. It needs to be minimum, it doesn't need to be high, because obviously if you have lots of damping, then it's difficult to turn, but most importantly, when you want to correct, it's not free enough, and it doesn't move freely enough, and you're going to be slow, and you won't be able to correct it. And as I said, we found out that many wheels, even if we applied the damper on the core of the game, do not apply damper from the driver as well. So what we did, we've put this damper setting here. Here's my recommendation. Please try it. Go to your driver of the steering wheel, or the same steering wheel here if you have a Fanatec, for example, find the pure damping, not the natural damping, not the friction damping, whatever. Find the pure damping, raise it to 100 from the drivers, okay? Raise it to 100 from the drivers, and then get into here and start playing in-game with this slider. What is the result that you want to achieve? Okay, because that's important. Why you want to play with this and get the result that you want to achieve. The result is that you need a steering wheel that it is free when you want to counter steer, free enough with a little bit of constant friction. Constant friction. But that constant friction is something that you just feel it. It shouldn't be too high, okay? But at the same time, you need enough damping that when you go in the straight line, like Monza, and you do to your steering wheel something like this, a little bit, you know, not too much. The steering wheel should do 1, 2, 3, and get back straight. So let me show you maybe this, how it works, okay? So let's go to Monza. For Fanatec, you should find it inside in the steering wheel in the various screens of the LED screen. It should be there. So let's go to Monza. Okay. Maybe hot stint so that we can start from the back straight. And let's see what's going on. I would just leave it as it is, we don't care. Alright, so straight line, go up to speed, not slow speed, because obviously nothing will happen. So So let's go up to speed. Around 200 kilometers per hour should be enough. 250, whatever. Okay, go completely straight. Okay, now if you leave the steering wheel, nothing will happen. Even if you move the steering wheel, look at this. I move it, and then it just goes straight again. Obviously, if you overdo it, it will keep on going. But after a while, and the faster you go, the more it will move. But you need enough damping to have the steering wheel, you know, realign itself and stay straight. Okay, and if we go now into the options and eliminate the damping here, completely zero. Let me see, because I don't remember if I have it also correctly here. Return to the garage and restart. Okay.
All right, mate. This session is about consistency. Try to be fast, but don't push it too much over the limit.
All right. Okay, where is it? Okay, so now my steering wheel is really completely free. Look at that. Boom! It's really, I mean, can you see it how it moves? It's really completely free. Many people are using their steering wheels like that. I don't think that's a good idea. So, first of all, you will feel the car extremely willing to rotate and stable, etc., because it doesn't have a constant feel of rubberness, you know, from the tires. But anyway, let's go. Let's move on. And now we are at the straight again. Let's move it. Look at that. That's not good. That's not how real cars and real steering wheels work. So I just touched it and then it did instantly everything by itself. What you need, as we said, is that you need to have enough damping that when you move it around, okay, or is it something like that? Yeah. Sorry. Okay. So you want enough damping that when you move this around, you want to feel some of the dampening. You want to have the steering wheel, you know, stay, have some friction. It's like, you know, forcing the tires to turn around. Okay. Keep in mind something, because of the natural damping, which is a different thing. Natural damping is a different thing. When you are stopped like this, even with the damper at zero, you will still feel some of the friction, because you are stopped and the tires have friction when you're stopped. You want to check this when you are already moving, okay? So like that. Okay. So this is my advice again. Play a little bit with the dampers, and my advice is don't go for a completely free steering wheel. It's not correct. You need a tiny bit of damping. You need to fine tune it a little bit. You need a tiny bit of damping. This is for all steering wheels. It doesn't matter if you have a G27 or a Thrustmaster or a Fanatec or a Simu Cube. Obviously, the high-end wheels have even more settings to play with, but even on the lower setting in the consumer steering wheels, there's still some damping to play with. And I believe, again, don't overdo it. The steering wheel still has to be free to turn around, but you need a little bit of damping. And in my opinion, if you put a tiny little bit of damping, you will also feel the car more stable for your input. So you will turn, and the steering wheel will stay, stable, and the whole car will follow the steering wheel to do the things that it should do. Okay? No, it's not mainly for direct drive wheels. It's for everybody. It's for everybody. All right. So this is it, guys, for tonight. I hope you liked it. As I said, we just started. There are so many things to talk about. The things that we talk tonight, I will cut them and post them in separate smaller right, doesn't work. Professional YouTuber, please give me a moment. Okay, so, as I said, all the things that we talk about tonight, I will cut in smaller videos, and I will post them as Too Long Didn't Watch in the Too Long Didn't Watch playlist. We just started talking about the new stuff into the tires and the physics and everything. We still have plenty of things to talk about and interesting things on that. Stay tuned, watch the social and the Discord server. I guess tomorrow we're going to do another live stream and maybe one more again after tomorrow. Have fun. Last advice I can give you for the guys that might have issues, game crashes, or they don't find what to expect, etc. Make sure that everything you customized in INI's JSON files and everything, don't do that. We always say that. Clean everything up. Let the game, run from scratch, possibly, if you have made strange physics engine.inis or JSON files or strange force feedback, whatever, I don't know. Clean that stuff up, rename it, save it somewhere as a backup, let the game redo, put new drivers, restart everything. And most of the people right now are really enjoying the game. And by most, I mean vast majority. I see some people having issues. This is normal for every big update, but this is my advice. Clean your stuff if you have strange issues and go to the forums, ask for advice, go to the Discord server, ask for advice. Everybody is there to help you. We will help you as much as we can. Don't worry about it. We can deal with this. All right? Okay. Thank you so much, guys. Hope you enjoyed the new version. Thank you. Thank you so much for your support during all this pandemic. This is why we're doing, everybody. We love sim racing. This is why we do all this for you and for us. Thanks again. See you next time. Bye.